which one is next? Oh. Which one is next? Yeah, that would be better. So this presentation will be having a few of the contents like wheat. We will talk about wheat, wheat ras, genetics of wheat, very short note, and what are the high throughput technologies which are available. I will not go into the details, but I will mention few of them so we can use as a breeders or pathologist to make use of them for identification and mapping. We will see how we start out going for identification or discovery of resistant genes, and we map major and minor QTLs, and we'll talk little about the project which I had with the Australian University of Sydney, that's fast track integration of rust resistant genes, which I did there. So we all know wheat is an important cereal. It's almost 19% to the cereal production. It contributes, and 18 million hectares is covered the worldwide. We have to understand its importance, because by 2050, we always talk about increasing it to, the population is increasing to 9 billion, and to now feed them, we have to increase 60% increase we have to achieve in, as far as wheat production is concerned. So 60% is today what we get, these whatever the varieties we have, they are going up to 5 tons per hectare, up to 6 quintals we have. So if you make it 60% of that, one day we will be having 110 quintals of yielding varieties we need. So our future generations like you, we have to concentrate on improving these varieties, and at the same time, parallelly, we have to breed them for resistance to rust. So if you look at the wheat, it's 2 lakh years ago, it started its evolution. The first, the evolution of wheat contains 3 haploid genomes. One is A, B, and D. Those genome, the species which are containing these haploid genomes, they came, diploid genomes, they came together. There were 2 hybridization. If you look at here, this is the first hybridization was leading to tetraploid wheat that we call it as a durum wheat. The second one is the durum wheat we use it for making pasta, and it is very common in central part of India. That's Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, and all, where temperatures not cooler compared to the northern part of India. So the domesticated wheat is Triticum hirsutivum. It contains 3 genomes. 3 diploid genomes have come together, A and B and D, and it has formed into the domesticated one. So wheat genus is called, it belongs to the Triticum genus, and family is Poaceae. So as I said, the diploid species we call as monococcum, tetraploid we call it as a dicoidea, and exoploid species as hirsutivum. So as far as genome is concerned, diploid species has only a genome. There is 7 homolog chromosomes, and tetraploid wheat have 28 chromosomes, homolog chromosomes, and exoploid has 21 that you, if you take it a copy, it becomes 42 chromosomes. Next, please. So before going to the actual identification or discovery or mapping of genes, we have to have a lot of genomic information available for particular crop. Wherever the crop is having more of genomic information, it is very easy to breed, very easy to identify markers. So once you identify markers, you can analyze the trait and marker analysis, and even you can study the diversity of this crop and its evolution, how it has happened. So its wheat genome is a monstrous big. If you compare it with other genomes which are already sequenced, which have been sequenced, rice is having only 419 MB of genome size. If you look at chicken, it is having 1.3 GB genome. And if it is in corn, it's nearly 2.3 GB. So if you compare that with the wheat, it is having 17 GB of genome. So that's nearly 16 billion DNA letters, DNA types it's having in its blood. So we have to sequence that whole information. It takes a lot of efforts. And out of this 16 billion DNA letters, what we call 7 GB, it's almost 80% is a junk DNA, which is not which is not coding for anything which is useful for us. So 80% is junk DNA. Only 2% of it is coding into genes, into the transcriptome, into the protein that is useful for plant growth and establishments. If you look at the three genomes individually, individually it is having 7 chromosomes here, homolog chromosome. In durum wheat, we have 14, and in tetraploid, we'll be having 21. So if you consider rice genome, it is 419 MB, and it is having nearly 50,000 genes in its blood. But wheat genome, you take it as a 17 billion DNA letters, and it's 17 GB of the genome, and it's giving only 1,50,000 genes. So that's the kind of variation we have in the coding sequence and repetitive sequences in this one. And the genome sequence projects, if you look at, we have 3-4 projects. Sorry. So there are many projects have been completed already. For example, rice, tomato, potato, and recently draft genomes of chickpea and pigeon pea were out. And still, this wheat genome sequencing is going on. It's not yet completed, and now it has been stopped, and it's awaiting its funding. So we have not yet sequenced the whole genome, 17 GB genome of wheat. Next, please. So we know all this information. We know how big this genome is, wheat genome is. So how far we can exploit that genome information so as to use it for our day-to-day breeding activities or day-to-day genomic studies. So if you look at the wheat genomes information and what are the genotyping facilities we have got and high throughput marker technologies which are available, the first thing comes to mind is SNP discovery. So the SNPs are very simple codominant markers. Those are very vast, available vast in a vast amount in the genome, and they can be used for a genotyping or studying the evolution or diversity of this species. Earlier, what we used to do is we used to use the first generation sequencing, that was the Sanger. And in one experiment, you can sequence or you can type 100 to a segment of 15 to 200 nucleotides. But the next generation sequencing has enormously changed the way we go for genotyping or we sequence the larger genomes, the complex genomes like wheat. Wheat is 17 GB. We do not use that vast genome sequence information. You have to reduce it because you have to remove 80% of the repetitive sequence information and you have to search for gene-specific markers. So you have only 2%. Or if you have 20% of out of this 100% total genomic DNA. So there are two methods were very efficient. One was reduced representation libraries and genotyping by sequencing. These two works on a principle of restriction enzymes. Restriction enzymes cut the DNA fragments, cut into DNA fragments, then adapters will be ligated. And these sequences will be multiplied by using a PCRs, small segments, and their copy number is studied. When the copy numbers are very high, that indicates that there is a lot of repetitiveness in the DNA. So it is coming from many number of chromosomes because it's having 21 individual homologous chromosomes. It's coming from copy numbers from all the different chromosomes. So wherever the copy number is low, those sequences can be taken out because that says it is very unique sequence. So that sequence can be used to develop, you can use it for sequencing and you can use it for identifying SNPs after that sequence. So Sanger, I said it's 15 to 200 nucleotides you can type in one experiment. But next generation sequencing is concerned, you can type 1 MB of DNA segment in a one experiment. That's nearly 1 million of DNA bases. That's 10 lakh bases you can do it in one experiment. Next, please. So once you have the genomic information, you have the sequence of those fragments which are useful for you, then you have to identify the diversity through markers. So SNPs are the available diverse codominant markers. So everyone will be looking at it. So and many crops have been used. They have used the germplasm or the any other mapping populations to develop chips. The first one, the first chip to came out from wheat was 9K iSelect chip. It was in 2013. USA scientists, in collaboration with Melbourne scientists, Matthew Hidden, they have developed a chip called 90K iSelect bead assay by using 27 accessions from USA and Australia. Only the negativity of this chip is they have used only the lines which were from US and Australia, but it was not covering the whole worldwide germplasm collections. So the next one came was a 90K SNP array chip. This was developed again by a Melbourne scientist, Matthew Hayden group. So it's a 90K SNP iSelect array. It's 90,000 different markers, SNPs, which can differentiate your line of interests based on the polymorphism. So they use nearly 794 accessions, worldwide accessions, which are covering Canada, Asia, USA, and Australia. And they have put them together, and they have made a chip. If you want to map your population, just you send them your DNA, and they will give you 90,000 marker data for your whatever the mapping population you send them. So once you have a genotyping technology, genotyping will be a very random process. So you have a polymorphic markers, you know the SNPs. Which one, the one I forgot, diversity array technology. This is also happens, works on the principle of hybridization. When your fragment is there, if it hybridizes somewhere in the genome, that can be identified and it can be used as a marker. Once you have a markers, this profile of 90,000K, your marker of interest is something, one marker of your gene of interest. You want to know what are the markers which are linked to that gene. So then we have to identify specific SNPs out of 90,000 which is going with your mark, with your gene of interest. So you have to have a repeatable, like it can work across the laboratory and it is most robust, what we call, that kind of marker platforms to validate those markers. So you are converting the chip-based marker into PCR-based marker, which you can use it as a single one and you can map those marker gene of interest. So there are three mainly, three platforms were available. Golden Gate, it's already closed. It's not available now. So Illumina is giving Infinium assays these days. And Life Technologies, Tacman assay, this also works on, these three works on the principle of fluorescence. You have a two forward primers, one for specific two alleles. One is having SNP, one without SNP. And one reverse primer will be same. So they will differentiate one fragment with SNP and without SNP. That way you can differentiate your real populations. If you look at here, the blue color, it indicates it's homozygous for recessive allele, recessiveness of that gene. And the one which is in orange color, it is giving homozygous for your trait. If you, you are looking for capital R, that is a resistant, and smaller, capital Rs are wherever the mapping population line that real is having a homozygous capital R, then it is giving this color. And when it is smaller, which is susceptible plants will give this color, and the heterozygotes will this color, give this color. So this will be highly robust, and you can apply this, you can use this primer anywhere around the world. Next, please. So once you have validated, next is you will develop, you have a genotypic data, you have a population, then you will go for constructing genetic maps. First genetic map of wheat came in 2004 by Somers. He used four different maps, he combined it together, and he constructed a map of 1,295 SSRs, only 1,295 SSRs, which were collected from all over the world, even including bark in India. Then this was amended with some more markers, STS markers and SSR markers, you can see here. Songers, he published a paper in 2008 with additional markers. I'm just giving example for 1 year, but there are more number of, like 20 more homologous chromosomes where you have to show that map. So 90K chip, I was talking about, I select 90K, where it is containing 9,000, and one study by Kevinog in 2014, He did it in nearly 1,200 accessions. So they could get out of 9,000, nearly 1,000, 2,000 markers which were polymorphic. That is too huge. And if you get in a population 1,000 to 2,000 polymorphic, which are differentiating your appearance, that's so huge. The next one was highly saturated 90K SNP chip. If you look at here, this is the one they developed. This shows the number of SNPs. And they have used land races, Asia's lines, USA, Europe, Canada, Australia, and some of the Durham. All those accessions, what I said, 794 accessions, they genotyped, they sequenced, and genotyped. So hexaploid wheat, this shows number of SNPs unique to tetraploid wheat. This shows number of SNPs unique to hexaploid. That means 10,041. These many number of SNPs only sitting on D genome, only those seven chromosomes. So here if you see 10,251 were sitting on A and B genomes, because A and B comes from tetraploid also and hexaploid also. And only these many were specific to hexaploid, that only sitting on A and B, not on D, that were found. Next, please. So we know by now that there is a lot of genomic information is available, even though wheat genome is very big, but still we could reduce the genomic information into the segments where the coding sequences and reducing the repetitive sequences. Then we will have our objective. Like anyone can breed for abiotic stress, anyone can breed for biotic stresses. The information used, information generated is same for everything. But that can be applied to any kind of mapping, any kind of identification of gene, or any kind of marker-assisted interrogation. These markers are universal to any kind of traits what we target. Today, I will mainly target on wheat RUS. So we all know RUS are very dangerous pathogens which affect wheat. So they are dangerous in a way that they are biotrophic. They live on the living organisms, and they are widely adapted, and they have capability, that aggressiveness to evolve from one pathotype to the next pathotype, and they can knock out your gene which was resistant earlier. So we have three kinds of RUS. Already you know earlier slides, there are a lot of things have been covered already. Next one. So if you look at individually, as far as evolution of pathotypes is considered, stem RUS is very aggressive. It can give you to the pathotypes which are very, very dangerous. And if you look at the temperature regime which is required for these rust to affect, for leaf rust, there is a large temperature regime. Temperature regime, it can cause disease. That's under low light conditions, if it is 2 degrees, until 35 degrees when high light intensity. And it can cause up to 40 to 70%. That is so huge. We talk about 2050 increasing 60%, and we talk about this one. Just imagine there is something like a situation where no one is working on resistance breeding. We will stop it, and no one will go forward with identification of genes or introgressing into the varieties. Imagine after 10 years, what may happen? What we talk about 40 to 70%, it may not be happening now. If we stop it or if we neglect it, it may cause 10 to 40%. That's the understanding what we get here. So the second one is yellow rust. It having a temperature regime, it needs cooler temperatures. It is not much prominent in central part of India. It's more prominent in northern part of India. We divide it in northern western plain zones and northern eastern plain zones, what we call. And stem rust, more prominent in Africa these years. There are so many races of UG99, which is causing devastating losses to African farmers. And it is having ability to cause 50 to 70% of losses. And the temperature regime is too, it needs higher temperature to cause disease. Next one, please. Next one, please. Neora. Just, yes, okay. You close this one. So before going to the details, how we identify and discover, just we will see a video. Just to come out from your mind, maybe boring or some kind of thing. Just we will look at this video. So this video was developed यू कैन क्लोज दिस फ्रॉम हियर, यहाँ से बंद कर दीजिए.
कर्सर नहीं जा रहा, ये देखिए वो इस पे देख तो रहा.
ओके, इसमें मिनिमाइज कर दीजिए. जा रहा है इसमें.
एक्चुअली नीचे वो है ना लकड़ी.
So this is the video. It was made for STEM Rust, BGRI, Borla Group of Rust Initiative, in collaboration with CSIRO, which is placed in Canberra, Australia. They have developed this video. It's not coming.
This wheat crop stem is being attacked by a parasite. The parasite is called rust, although it is actually a type of fungus. The invading rust fungus has penetrated deep.
Started from front. It's coming actually. Now you play the video. You reconnect it. Just you close, remove and one second, no?
System
lagana tha. Wi-Fi nahi connect ho raha tha.
Nahi ho raha
bhai. Waise download video bhi
hai. Nahi, wo actually copyrighted hai, so. At least okay, the video we can see it on the end. If PowerPoint can come, just PowerPoint. कॉपी किया मेरे को.